Good morning, Brazil. Hello, everybody. Great pleasure to be here today. 6G Flagship is one of the, or probably the first major 6G research program globally. We started already in May 2018. It's a 4+4 year program funded by Academy of Finland, which is our national funding institution. And we just started second phase of the flagship this year. Results so far have been really encouraging. Our work has been widely recognized. We have been able to grow critical mass of our researchers very nicely during the first 4 years. And also scientific output has been steadily increasing, as well as the number of different projects that we have been operating within Flagship so far. Our program has quite broad research agenda, and this is something quite unique. At least I haven't encountered this type of program in other places yet. Maybe they are coming. Of course, as a university, our main goal is to carry out highest level academic research in various relevant technology areas that we see important for 6G era. Besides that, we feel very strongly that it's extremely important to be actively participating some of the regulation processes and be actively suggesting whatever is needed to be changed for the future concerning 6G. Also, some of the changes that we require for regulation are coming from future new business opportunities. So understanding this techno-economical reasoning, why something should be changed, why it's no longer enough to rely on current existing mobile network operators is important. So we have various different scenarios related to digitalization of societies in the future, what type of players and actors we need, what kind of ecosystems, value chains we must have in place in order to make these changes fast enough. Sustainability is overarching theme in most of the European research institutions these days, as we know that we have serious challenges concerning the future of our globe, and many things need to be addressed. And I dare to claim that wireless research community has not done at all enough in that respect. We can do much more, and that's why it's important to address these sustainability targets as well in the research. If you are interested, you can go to our website and download some of our white papers that have been published during the first phase of the flagship. These were produced in collaboration with 250 experts around the world. They are coming from, if I recall it right, 35 different countries and 100 organizations. And these white papers were crafted with the leadership of our senior researchers of various disciplines. So this has been really well received around the world and have been downloaded already over 1 million times. The visions and ideas there are still highly relevant, and we don't expect these to change much also concerning the coming years. One of the things that we have been addressing quite a lot, and now we are happily recognizing that this is more and more also discussed in ITUR processes and other regulatory bodies, besides these technical targets and requirements for future mobile systems, it's very, very important to talk about key values, value indicators, as we call them. These are extremely hard to quantify or measure exactly numerically, but these are extremely important issues to be discussed as a part of regulation and standards processes in the coming years. As we know, we have everywhere worries about the privacy and security of wireless and networks in general, and this is an important aspect that we must take care of. If this future vision of Internet of Things is really happening as massively as we expect, privacy and security is one of the key things to make absolutely certain that people are not afraid of their valuable information to be misused. Many other things as well relate to key values. And like I said, hard to quantify, important to discuss early on. When we look a little bit back in mobile generations, there has always been what we may call killer application driving mobile generations forward. The first two generations, they were mainly voice oriented. Then mobile broadband came into play gradually with 3G and more with 4G. And now when 5G has appeared, the key question is that, okay, what comes next? What is the killer application? Why should I bother buying 5G mobile phone as a consumer? Well, so far we are still stuck to this mobile broadband as a major use case and not so greatly improved user experience compared to 4G, but the expectations have not disappeared anywhere. 5G has laid down a huge number of expectations for productivity of society in broad sense, and those targets and requirements have not disappeared anywhere. If I would look back at what European Commission stated as the targets for 5G somewhere in 2013-14, and later on ITU-R made as IMT 2020 requirements in 2015, those are still valid for 6G. So it really means that these mobile generations don't happen overnight. We actually basically need two generations to make these frog leaps to something totally new. So when developing 6G, one of the first things that we have to make available is to really try to make sure that the targets set for 5G are really happening and coming to available for everybody. What we think, both with 5G and more so towards 6G, is that there are different very important vertical sectors which will be driving some of the technology development also for the future. This one technical solution fitting all possible problems kind of thinking has to step aside a bit. We need a lot of customization of radio access networks for different use cases. It's totally different when we are developing something like for agriculture, for example, and then compare what we need in health sector, in hospitals or industry or automotive sector. They are all very different. The players in each of these verticals are different. The technical requirements for the systems are different. And the reasons why we utilize these advanced wireless technologies in these are quite different. And the applications are, of course, totally different. So this is one of the major changes that we expect to happen when 6G standardization is eventually starting. Another important thing relates to spectrum regulation, but I would like to broaden it to regulation in more general terms. Of course, spectrum regulation is very important for us wireless engineers and researchers, but there are field-specific regulations like in agriculture or health sector or automotive sector that have to go hand in hand with this wireless technology development. So regulatory processes have to enable whatever is coming in the future and this local network's appearance in the future and potentially allocating more spectrum for local networks in the future. That is very much in line how we see future happening, because more and more traffic is generated from indoors, from very local places, and we have to make sure that in such environments, the networks are well suitable to the purpose. We have really tailored solutions for very specific use cases. And this is actually already happening in 5G private networks. But we need more than that, I think. Of course, when talking about 6G, it's all about higher and higher data rates. And this is very trivial way of showing how we can increase the capacity in the future. First of all, we need more spectrum. That is very clear. And now, since the lower spectrum bands are more or less occupied, we are going to higher and higher spectrum bands, talking about even sub-terahertz, upper millimeter wave bands, etc., etc. Another thing is that we have to spatially split the serving base station coverage areas to smaller and smaller cells, bringing the base stations or access points closer to end users' indoor environments, basically increasingly, so that we can reuse the same spectrum over and over again within the same geographical area. These two are the most efficient ways to increase capacity of future systems. And if you look back into history, this is exactly what has happened. The third one, improving spectrum efficiency. This is, very important for us researchers. We are playing with new transmission mechanisms. We are introducing more and more complicated, but yet more efficient transmission mechanisms utilizing multi-antenna technologies, intelligent reflecting surfaces, and you name it. The potential capacity increase via these is modest compared to these other two, but still important. We have to keep pushing the technology development to the limits, and it happens over there. One example about spectrum regulation, new policies, we introduced already back in 2015 a micro-operator concept, which is basically a local operator, which is given a frequency bands for regional, local usage, and without going into details in this, but this is really radically new idea compared to how mobile networks are operating today under existing operators. Private 5G networks is the right step towards this direction, but besides what they are doing now, for example, in Japan and Germany, 5G private networks would also allow roaming, so that if I built this type of local network to a shopping mall, for example, I would like that any operator customer could utilize the services that I'm offering to the visitors. So if I summarize a bit our views on what are key things towards 6G, first of all, digital inclusion via global coverage. We have to take into consideration that there is currently 4 billion people around the world without any internet connectivity. It's now about the time to make sure that everybody can get connected at reasonable cost. Usually these remote areas are poor areas, and the solutions that we are offering to metropolitan areas, wealthy countries, are not suitable for those areas necessarily, or very rarely even. And that's why we have to tailor those solutions specifically for remote area communications. And what Luciano presented earlier on this agriculture example, very much agree with that kind of thinking. We have to challenge the current MNO-centric business models, like I explained earlier. Global collaboration is these days more and more important as the world has gone a little bit turbulent during the past years. And it's very important that we can globally agree on standards for the future as well as we are used to now for a relatively long time. Different technical key points and targets that we must be addressing. Maybe if I pick here one, the super efficient connectivity at high spectrum bands is probably the mostly on our research currently. We are talking about many different things when we talk about super efficiency. It can be extreme speeds, really high reliability. It can mean very accurate positioning or other sensing capabilities and so forth. And mainly we are looking at very high spectrum bands when the super efficiency is discussed, as there's plenty of bandwidth to be used for achieving the efficiency. If you're interested in following some of our works, we have published our latest 6G Waves magazine, which you can download from our website. These white papers are available there, and every June we organize in collaboration with European Commission this EU-CNC 6G Summit event. This year it's in Gothenburg in Sweden during the first week of June. The paper submission will be opened these days, so please submit your works there and join the conference in Gothenburg. Thank you very much.